Good afternoon. I'm going to talk about Carmenes, which is the name of both an instrument that we built for the Cala Alto Observatory in southern Spain and also for a survey of M-dwarfs that we are conducting there. Carmenes, as I said, is both an instrument and a survey, and the instrument was specifically built to look for planets around M-dwarfs. The Carmenes Consortium is a group of German and Spanish institutions, 5 German, 5 Spanish, and a German-Spanish observatory. And what we are doing is we are using the radio velocity technique. So we take spectra of M-dwarfs, we measure very precisely what the radio velocity is, and we use that to look for planets. So this method is very well known. The big issue is in the numbers. So if you put in the numbers for an analogon to the Earth, you get a radio velocity amplitude of 9 centimeters per second. So normally astronomers are using measuring velocities in kilometers per second. We have now been pushing to meters per second, but that kind of precision is beyond what can be done at the moment technologically, and also beyond what the stars let us do, because the stars themselves are active. A star is not a steady object that just moves back and forth. There are all kinds of processes at the surface that produce radio velocity jitter. It's interesting astrophysics, but for looking for planets is a source of noise. So if you are interested in habitable planets and finding them with this technique, there is this problem that the radio velocity amplitudes are just very, very small. So in that situation, M-dwarfs offer a convenient shortcut. M-dwarfs are much lighter, and they are much less luminous than G-type stars. So this means that the habitable zone is much closer to the star, and therefore the radio velocity signal is much higher. So this is illustrated in this plot, where on one axis, the x-axis shows the orbital distance, the y-axis is the mass, or here are the corresponding classes in astronomy jargon, the subtypes of M stars. And the gray band marks the habitable zone, so the lower the mass, the closer to the star is the habitable zone. And the red lines illustrate the performance of a certain spectrograph or the measurement precision with a certain survey. And you can shift these to the left or right a little bit, depending on how long you expose, how many observations you take, and so on. But the basic feature is, if you take this curve here, everything that is to the right, the signal is too small, you can't observe it. Everything to the left, the signal is good enough. And you see that for an M star, the habitable zone is nicely in the observable region, whereas our solar system is completely out. So this is the M star advantage for looking, if you're interested in habitable planets. There's a second nice advantage, and that is that the periods in the habitable zone are much shorter. That is also one difficulty if you're observing from the ground. If you're looking for habitable planets around solar-type stars, they have typical orbital periods of 1 year, and that creates problems because you can never really observe a full cycle because of the aliasing effect. You can observe the star for one season, and then it is too close to the sun to observe, and then you can come back next year, but you always observe it at the same orbital phase if it has a 1 year period. Here the orbital periods are so short that you can easily observe several periods in one observing season, which is great, especially for a ground-based survey. Of course, this doesn't come for free. There are problems with M-dwarfs, and the biggest problem is that M-dwarfs are very active. M-dwarfs are typically more active than the Sun. They are active for a longer time. And because the habitable zone is closer to the star, the planet itself sees more of that activity. So activity is a problem for finding the planet because it generates jitter in the radial velocities. It's also potentially a problem for habitability because the UV radiation may affect the atmosphere and eliminate the atmosphere in the early phase of the life of the planet. Nevertheless, we are of course interested in these objects, and so when I will say habitable zone or speak about potentially habitable planets, I'm kind of glossing over this issue that there may be a problem for the survival of the atmosphere. So the stars that we are looking at are shown here in a histogram, where on the x-axis we plot the mass. So this is another thing to remember. When people talk about M stars, there is a very, very wide range in mass that is covered here. The lower end is objects like TRAPPIST-1 that have a mass around 0.08 solar masses, which is just the limit of where hydrogen burning starts, and the M range goes up to 0.6 solar masses. So this is a factor of 7 or so in stellar mass. So if you think about it on a logarithmic scale, the M star range is larger than K, F, and G taken together. K, G, and F, I should say, taken together. M, really, the so-called early M's, the more massive M stars, are 7 times or so more massive than the low mass M stars. So now that explains our survey goals. First of all, we are interested in finding nearby and potentially habitable planets. Oh, I should point out one thing I forgot on the last view graph. I forgot to point out the average distance of our survey stars is 13 parsecs. So we are really looking in the solar neighborhood. We are looking at 300 M stars, and they are all really, really close compared to other surveys. The Kepler stars are several hundreds of parsecs away, for instance. So we are interested in nearby and potentially habitable planets. We are interested in exploring the physics of planetary system formation around low mass stars with a relatively large range in mass that we can cover. And at the same time, we are interested in characterizing the properties of the M stars and their activity to learn more about what the influence of the star on the habitability may be. So with these goals in mind, we started thinking about what kind of instrument do we want to build. So first of all, Kamenes is a single purpose instrument. It doesn't mean you couldn't do other great astrophysics with it, but it was built with one purpose in mind, namely to do this survey. So we knew we need very high stability to get the sensitivity to Earth mass planets. We needed operation in the near red, in the red and near infrared. So unlike some other instruments that work in the very blue, where these stars are extremely faint, we work in the red and near infrared, and we build it with a large wavelength range so that we can cover many activity indicators and get chromatic information. Come back to that point. So here's a very rough overview. There is an element that is called the front end that's attached to the telescopes, and then we have optical fibers that send the light into two spectrographs. One of them is a visible light, the red part of the visible spectrum, and the other one is a near-infrared spectrograph. So here, a very quick summary of the main properties for those that are more interested in the technical details. The resolution of the spectrographs are around 80 to 90,000. We aim at the precision of 1 meter per second. The two spectrographs together cover a very wide wavelength range from about 0.5 microns to 1.7 microns. They are in vacuum tanks and made highly stable. So we spent several years building those spectrographs. And then comes the nerve-wracking time when you see the work of several years dangling on a crane and to be lifted down to the telescope. And we did this 2 years ago. And then we got first light with those two spectrographs. And this is then what you get when you take an exposure. So here, this shows, this is the output from the visible light spectrograph. So this is a very long spectrum going from 0.5 microns to 0.95 microns up here. And then here is the infrared spectrum going from 0.96 microns to 1.7, all wrapped on this detector. And here I have blown up a very small piece of this part. And here you see a calibration spectrum. This is from a Fabry-Perot that's in the lab. And up here you can see a very small section of the stellar spectrum. And there are the stellar lines that we are measuring. And you, first of all, you can see there's an enormous information content in these spectra to learn more about these stars and how they influence the planets. And second of all, we have very many lines for which we can measure the radial velocity. And by averaging over these very, very many measurements, we can get then a very good value for the Doppler shift. So here are some examples. This is a very small section. You see this runs from 9,800 angstroms to 10,000 angstroms. So this whole part is 200 angstroms or 20 nanometers out of the spectrum. And here we compared our data with models. And the first thing we see is that for several stars, you get very good. So these are the warmer M stars. Here's a comparison hot star. Here are some warmer M stars for which the predictions from models were pretty good. But then this one here is, the prediction is very far off. So here we see one of the things that we are addressing with our new data is we learn more about the spectra and the properties of these M stars. And we are just about to publish a library of 300 of these high resolution spectra with very wide wavelength coverage, which is then the best library of M star spectra in the literature. So one of the things that I mentioned is we are covering this wide wavelength range. One of the purposes is we want to get lines that are indicative of stellar activity. And for instance, here you see H alpha sticking out as a very strong emission line. So this specific star is very active. The line is, in many of these objects, is very variable. So we can catch flares and see the influence of the variability on the spectrum. And we are interested also in looking at star spots. And star spots have two effects. One is they block some light. And also, there is an effect that they move from the side of the star that's coming towards you to the side that's going away from you. And with that, you get an effect on the radial velocity that is a curve like this. And this curve has a larger amplitude in the blue than it has in the red. And if you plot these radial velocities here as a function of wavelength, then the spread is relatively large in the blue and much smaller in the red. So this tells you, if you see something like this, that the variability of the radial velocity is due to a spot and not to a planet. This is a model simulation, and these are our data. So in this case, you see very clearly, we have the same effect, large amplitude here, small there, and that means we can distinguish between radial velocity signals from the stellar atmosphere and signals from planets very nicely. Here are radial velocities on a star that was known to have a planet from three different instruments. Our data are the red ones, and blue and green are from two other prominent instruments from the literature. And we can compare also with Hobbs data that did an M-dwarf survey, and we see that we get roughly the same scatter in the data, so they are dominated, the scatter is dominated by stellar activity. I'll skip this and go to this, which I think is my last slide before the summary. And so this is our first planet discovery that was just in our data and not known before. And in this case, it is a planet that is in the habitable zone of the parent star. So this is shown in green here. The mass is a bit too high to be habitable. It's 25 Earth masses, but now we are digging in our data that we have for lower mass planets also. So we clearly have the capability to see those. And so thank you for your attention.